Good morning, and welcome to this week's View on Africa. My name's Omar Mahmoud, and I'm a senior researcher in the ISS Addis Ababa office in Ethiopia. And this week, I want to talk about the Red Sea maritime space, and specifically aspects of cooperation, competition, and security. And this is based off of a recent research report that we have done at the ISS that's available on our website, looking specifically into the Red Sea maritime space and aspects of management of that space and gaps in management and emerging mechanisms to deal with that. So I think we'll look at two key areas today. First, an explanation of why the Red Sea maritime space is so unique. What makes it such a complex but diverse geographical area. And secondly, in the report, we also look at a comparison of some other maritime regional governance aspects and mechanisms, and to see what sort of lessons or sort of aspects of cooperation that we've seen from other aspects that could be applied to the Red Sea itself. So to start, why is the Red Sea such a unique space? I think the first thing you have to look at is its strategic location. If you look at where the Red Sea is located, very near substantial oil-producing areas in the Gulf, in the Arabian Gulf, and then its trajectory towards markets in Europe and beyond, the amount of traffic going through this narrow corridor is very, very significant. And you tie that into geographic vulnerability. The Red Sea is a narrow space where at the top there's the Suez Canal in the north, and in the south there's the Bab al-Mandab. And these are two what they call geographic or maritime choke points in terms of being very narrow areas where a lot of maritime traffic passes through. And the fact that the Red Sea is bounded by both of these, one on the north and one on the south, increases its geographic and strategic importance. The third is the diversity of the states that make up the Red Sea. The Red Sea is really a convergence of a number of geopolitical subzones. You have the Arabian Peninsula, you have North Africa and the Levant, you have the Horn of Africa. And this diversity is important because it also plays out in terms of demographics or economics, for example. You have countries as small as Djibouti, less than 1 million people, to countries as large as Egypt that have littoral maritime Red Sea coasts. You have a wide diversity in terms of economics, huge oil-producing countries like Saudi Arabia, to countries that are in prolonged economic crisis like Sudan. And I think that plays out also in terms of the interaction between these countries within this space, especially in terms of do the economic dictates of larger countries and larger powers sort of predominate some other interests within the space. So I think that's another important aspect to look at, the diversity of the Red Sea space. And the last factor I'll point out, and all of these factors leading up kind of tie into this, but it's the amount of actors and amount of interest in the Red Sea space, because it's such a strategic important area, because of the number because of the range of diversity within it. So I think you have three different levels to look at here to examine geopolitics in this area. On the Horn side, you have a number of countries that are very pivotal and very important to the Red Sea space, but you also have aspects of state competition and rivalry within that. So you have some unresolved border issues between Djibouti and Eritrea, for example, or even the border between Sudan and Egypt hasn't been fully resolved. So it's not just that we have a number of interesting and diverse actors, but there's the presence of some levels of competition and rivalry. The second level is on the Arabian Gulf side, and there you have some division, some ongoing state-to-state interactions and rivalries which have been imported more or less to the Red Sea space. And I think the two key ones to point out here are, first of all, the dynamic between Saudi Arabia and Iran, this geopolitical competition for relevance and influence within the Arabian Gulf itself, but you see that playing out in the Red Sea. And the second, of course, is more recent, but the outbreak of the Gulf Cooperation Crisis, which has put Saudi Arabia, the UAE, Bahrain, and Egypt really against Qatar and by some association, Turkey as well. Well, that's also played out in the Red Sea maritime space. So these divisions complicate aspects of cooperation over maritime governance in the area as well. And the third factor I think you'd look at is a more global or wider level. You have very much the interests of the United States, of the EU, of China, and even to a degree Russia. So some of the world powers also being heavily interested in this space. And again, with some latent competition at times, that brings some complications into getting to sort of cooperative mechanisms in the Red Sea space as well. So I think that gives a bit of an overview of why the Red Sea is such a unique area. I think it'd be interesting to focus on some of the lessons learned that have come out from our recent paper. And in that, we looked at a few different similar maritime governance systems that are in very complex environments and very diverse environments and responding to some specific threats. And just to quickly list those, they are the Regional Cooperation Agreement on Combating Piracy and Armed Robbery Against Ships, or RECOP, which is based in Southeast Asia. This is also, there's an agreement called SUKBAS, or the Sea Surveillance Cooperation Baltic Sea, which is another maritime cooperative agreement. There's, of course, the Djibouti Code of Conduct, which occurs around the Indian Ocean area, and then also the Yaoundé Code of Conduct. And through those mechanisms that we chose for their applicability, I think there's a few key lessons to take. And the first is that mistrust or competition is a key factor that needs to be overcome in any sort of environment. And the inability to do that leads to some negative outcomes like duplicative efforts and also the non-participation of key states. And so I think you can look at a few different examples here. For example, looking at RECAP, it's been a successful maritime arrangement in the Southeast Asia, but it also suffers from the lack of participation of countries like Malaysia or Indonesia as full participants. And part of that's been due to some considerations over national sovereignty. And when you're looking at maritime issues, I think this needs to be taken into account as well. Two factors we'd seen through some of these arrangements to deal with these questions or mitigate these questions of national sovereignty. The first is to focus on a consensus-based decision-making model, and rather than imposing anything binding on countries that are a little uncomfortable with that or not quite willing to sign up that, consensus decision-making can help a bit, and we've seen this with the Djibouti Code of Conduct in particular. And the second interesting aspect we saw from the SUKBAS example in the Baltic state is some flexible tiers of engagement. And I think in that one in particular, there's three different levels of state engagement, a mandatory minimum level at the first dynamic, and then it goes up in terms of involvement, but also in terms of the willingness of states to participate. So they can come in just at the bottom level, or if they want, they can go a little bit higher. So there's again, a bit of flexibility built in there. The second, I think, lesson that jumped out at us was that some of these organizations have started small and expanded over time. Now, this is both in terms of scope, but also in terms of membership. And I think a good example of this comes with the Djibouti Code of Conduct, which was an agreement of 20 nations around the Indian Ocean to look specifically at aspects of piracy. Now, because of that successful engagement a few years later, they came back and added the Jeddah Amendment to the Djibouti Code of Conduct, which 17 of the 20 nations signed up. So not all of them, but still a very significant amount. And this expanded the range of maritime activities or maritime crimes they were looking at quite significantly. So they really built off of a smaller engagement into something larger. And we see that as well with some other organizations, including SUKBAS itself, which expanded in terms of its membership, initially focused very closely on the Baltic Sea, but adding even the UK later on. And so in this sense, it's useful often to start around a very common or narrow platform of activities. And the key one that's popped up over and over is information sharing. in terms of building confidence, in terms of understanding the threats that are present or the concerns in a given maritime space. And so that's been a key one to start from. Two other lessons that popped up. The first one ties in again a little bit with information sharing, but having a common set of platform or principles or even definitions of what organizations are looking at or what they want to achieve. And so I say this because the lack of a common sense on these aspects can lead to divergent outcomes. And again, we saw this in the recap example, particularly with one of the reasons why Indonesia has not participated is because their view of piracy is very much a domestic consideration versus an organization like RECAP, which has a bit more of an international focus. So coming to some sort of common denominator there is very key for building that consensus as well. And tied into this is that cooperation tends to be highest when the level of threat is very high. But in order to mitigate future threats, this must be sort of continued as well, even if threats subside. So I think we have an example now in the Indian Ocean area where piracy was a very significant threat 4, 5, 6 years ago and drove a lot of cooperation. Now, maybe it's not as big of a concern, but we've seen those networks still exist and some occasional attacks and incidents there. So without maintaining that cooperation, this could really very much reemerge. And the last point that I would make that stood out from some of the research is the need to have good coordination to avoid proliferation of initiatives and or overlap. So it's something I mentioned in the beginning. But again, we've seen from a number of these arrangements times where there's multiple reporting systems because of the lack of coordination or because of national interest in terms of where those are housed. Or we've seen some countries not participate because they felt that certain initiatives are overlapping. And so starting from a very coordinative standpoint is very important. And when we look at the Red Sea right now, there's a number of different initiatives that are emerging. You can look at what AU and EGOT are doing. You can look at the proposed Red Sea Forum and how that's advancing. But the concern would be the need for greater coordination going forward to ensure aspects are not duplicative and that they are not overlapping as well. I think that helps limit competition as well, which is something that's key in the Red Sea space. So I'll leave it there for this session. Thank you for tuning in. And there's many more details in our report on the Red Sea entitled Cooperation, Competition, and Security in the Red Sea Space, available on the ISS website. So hope to see you again next time.